Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Called to Reconciliation, How the Church Can Model Justice, Diversity, and Inclusion by Jonathan C. Augustine. Foreword by William Willimon. Afterword by Michael Curry. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Foreword. Here's the right book, at the right time, written by the right person, for the right reasons. Lots of folks are talking about and yearning for racial reconciliation. Jay Augustine joins that conversation and debate boldly by speaking up for reconciliation from an unashamed, uniquely Christian point of view. Jay adheres to a gumbo view of diversity. For all of us not from Louisiana, Jay explains, good gumbo is good because it's made with a variety of diverse ingredients, each one enriching the others. He believes that society is also better when it brings diverse people and diverse groups together. Then Jay moves into a Christian, richly biblical defense of diversity, and before he is done, he also offers guidance for how to achieve diversity in our churches for the sake of the world. While informed by current sociological, systemic, and critical theory accounts of our racialized culture, Jay dives right into theology, confident that our Christological convictions have real-life, here-and-now consequences. The whole New Testament is a response to the early church's shock and awe that God's salvation had exploded out from God's people, Israel, to include even us Gentiles. In your church and mine, God is busy gathering a people that looks different from the divisions, separations, and bogus dehumanizing ploys of the world. Every Christian, in every age, recapitulates Peter's encounter with Cornelius in Acts chapter 10. We who have been and are being reconciled to God in Christ are thereby free to expect and delight in our reconciliation to one another. Though he is thoroughly aware of the problematic aspects of the calls of white Christians for reconciliation with black Christians, when in America's history of white and black were we ever conciliated, he asks, knowing that pleas for reconciliation can be various forms of manipulation by the powerful, Jay still argues that reconciliation is at the heart of the Christian hope and witness. Christ puts pressure on his people to expect and work for diversity and to show the world what diversity looks like. Jesus Christ is not only reconciler, but also the one who convenes a people, the church, whose members become active agents of reconciliation. Examining the gospel's depiction of Jesus as boundary-breaking reconciler, then deep diving into Paul's challenge for early congregations to become showcases for God's reconciliation, especially in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 17 through 22, and Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28, Jay shows that issues of justice, diversity, and reconciliation are not extra add-ons that the church can opt out of as a matter of personal preference. They are an essential part of the gospel. Indeed, as an announcement of who God is and what God is up to in the world, the gospel, in both content and effect, is about reconciliation. Paul stressed the kingdom at hand as strongly as he stressed the kingdom to come. Christ gathers us in order that the church might be a showcase for what Christ is able to work in the world here, now, despite all the ways we try to separate from and divide one another. Through an astute reading of Paul's letter to the Romans, Jay detects a vertical plane representing humanity's reconciled relationship with God, salvific reconciliation, and a horizontal plane representing human beings' reconciled relationships with one another, social reconciliation. Christ is about reconciliation on both planes, promising a gumbo sort of church if we are faithful to his invitation to work with him. Salvific and social reconciliation then work together to enact civil reconciliation, which is primarily secular in intent and scope, but is rooted in Paul's theology of equality. Jay enables the ancient witness of the church to be as relevant and contemporary as the Black Lives Matter movement. He sets forth a challenge for how we do church as well as for how we conduct our politics. I'm sure that you will find Called to Reconciliation to be just what you need to equip yourself for living into the shock that, in Christ, God is reconciling the whole world to God and reconciling us all to one another. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. William H. Willeman, retired bishop, United Methodist Church, professor of the practice of Christian ministry, Duke Divinity School. Introduction. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. I grew up in New Orleans, and I love gumbo. Better stated, I love good gumbo. What makes a gumbo good? Some might say the seafood. Others might say the seasonings. Still others might even say the roux. As one of New Orleans' most popular foods, gumbo typically contains seafood and seasonings, and all gumbo begins with a roux. Good gumbo, however, incorporates difference. Good gumbo is good because it's made with a variety of diverse ingredients, each one enriching the others. I believe society is also better when it brings diverse people and diverse groups together in community because our perspectives and experiences are enriched by differences. If diversity is good for society, then it must also be good for the church. In this book, while I emphasize the importance of diversity and inclusion, with an egalitarian respect for all people and traditions, I also connect theology, legal history, and politics with diversity and inclusion practices. I link them through a discussion of reconciliation at a time when the United States of America is anything but reconciled. During the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. led the black church in moving toward reconciliation. King sought reconciliation between blacks and whites amid widespread enmity, as Jim Crow laws subjugated blacks to a caste system that marginalized black existence. Although laws may have changed, the systemic social barriers that marginalize minorities have persisted, as evidenced by the circumstances giving rise to the many Black Lives Matter protests throughout the United States beginning in 2013. The names Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and George Floyd will forever do more than remind Americans of generational racial disparities. Their names are Exhibit A in making the case that America must move toward reconciliation, racial and otherwise. As evidence that hope can always be found during despair, very clear demographic differences between the protesters of the 1960s and the protesters of the last few years suggest the United States now has an opportunity to move toward reconciliation by bringing diverse groups together. The modern-day Black Lives Matter protests are not majority black, a visible opposition to the American caste system that has castigated and marginalized blacks. Protesters are now people of all colors and races. Indeed, the rebirthed Black Lives Matter movement of 2020 proves that if all lives really do matter, black lives must matter too. Problems associated with racial discrimination cannot be unilaterally solved by blacks, no more so than problems associated with gender discrimination can be independently solved by women. True reconciliation cannot be done alone. It requires diverse people coming together, just like diverse ingredients come together in gumbo. The Black Lives Matter movement brought together people of all races, as well as corporate giants and nonprofit community organizers, in the seeking of social equity. More importantly, however, 2020's moment of reckoning, after a white Minneapolis police officer killed George Floyd by keeping his knee on Floyd's neck for 9 minutes and 29 seconds, clearly showed that America's social problems are better addressed when disparate groups come together to work in community. By doing so, groups have left identity politics behind to engage in equity practices aimed at reconciliation. As a counterargument, some claim that the concept of racial reconciliation is a misnomer because America's history of pervasive racism shows that there has never truly been conciliation, a relationship of unity and harmony between whites and persons of color in this country. Indeed, assuming that racial reconciliation is an attempt to restore a mythical harmony, which never existed, distorts and conceals the truth about America's sordid past. What some woke non-blacks have recently been made to realize, through books like Robin DiAngelo's White Fragility and tragedies like the violent killings of Taylor, Arbery, and Floyd, is that telling the truth means owning America's post-Reconstruction history of disenfranchising, marginalizing, and imprisoning blacks, including the Jim Crow system of racial segregation made possible by the Supreme Court's infamous ruling in Plessy v. Ferguson, 1896, establishing the separate but unequal doctrine, which had devastating social, educational, and economic repercussions. Owning America's truth is a requisite for moving toward reconciliation. In a similar vein, after the evil institution of apartheid came to an end in South Africa and Nelson Mandela became the country's first democratically elected president in 1994, Archbishop Desmond Tutu was appointed to lead the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission, a task force whose job it was to face the truth of South Africa's past in order to forge a common path forward for the future. In No Future Without Forgiveness, Tutu describes how the commission's work toward reconciliation was not at all concerned with retributive justice, where the goal is punitive. Instead, the commission's chief goal was restorative justice, where instead of retribution or punishment, the central concern is the healing of breaches, the redressing of imbalances, the restoration of broken relationships, a seeking to rehabilitate both the victim and the perpetrator, who should be given the opportunity to be reintegrated into the community he has injured by his offense. If the United States is also to move toward reconciliation, its social problems must likewise be addressed with honesty, by diverse groups coming together to create something new. Gumbo, anyone? Reconciliation in context. Reconciliation is one of the rare words that originates within the church, but that also applies in secular contexts. From a perspective with Christ at the center, it has to do with human beings being reconciled to God through Jesus. This is what I call salvific reconciliation, because it relates to human salvation. In the closely related social context, reconciliation also has to do with human beings being reconciled to one another as equals because of Jesus' saving work. I call this social reconciliation. What's the difference between the two? Whereas salvific reconciliation is focused on the kingdom to come, that is, it is soteriological or eschatological, social reconciliation is part of the here and now and is focused on the kingdom at hand, for example, on systemic social inequities. My focus herein is not so much on salvation or the concept of heaven. I focus instead on an egalitarian ethic, that is, on social equality, different groups embracing the other in a mutually beneficial and diverse community. Stated otherwise, social reconciliation looks like good gumbo. Before going further, to appropriately place my use of the term reconciliation in context as it relates to the construct of race in America, I find it helpful to distinguish between reconciliation and equity. Efforts at racial equity seek to remedy the structural racism historically embedded in America's cultural, political, social, and economic systems and institutions by seeking just and fair inclusion that allows all people to participate in society and reach their full potential. Reconciliation seeks to restore broken relationship by finding commonality as humans who are all created in God's image. While equity is primarily secular, reconciliation begins in a religious ethos and progresses to include secular communities. In this book, I set forth a theological basis for reconciliation by identifying a scriptural trajectory linking the leadership of Peter, Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 19, Acts chapter 2, and chapter 10, with the theology of Paul, illustrating how disparate groups can create community. This link makes for a gumbo-like variety that is rooted in equitable human relations. Refer to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 17 through 22. Moreover, this theology of equality is not only a core component of social reconciliation in Paul's letters, but also the basis for an ethical derivative of them, what I call civil reconciliation. civil reconciliation is what presumably fueled the Reverend Oliver Brown in Brown v. Board of Education, 1954, and the then barely known Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. in prophetically leading the black church into the politics of the civil rights movement. Insofar as social reconciliation embraces a fellowship that is no respecter of persons, Acts chapter 10, verse 34, civil reconciliation demands governmental and legal redress by placing different groups of people in community with one another. Stated otherwise, gumbo is not supposed to be a homogeneous soup, but a richly diverse delicacy. Consider Reverend Brown. As a minister at St. Mark's African Methodist Episcopal Church in Topeka, Kansas, Brown served in a denomination founded because of legal racial inequities and a desire for human equality. Brown sued the Topeka Board of Education on behalf of his daughter, Linda, who was denied admission to a local school because she was black. Describing the circumstances leading to litigation, legal scholars write, "The lead plaintiff, Oliver Brown, was angered that his daughter had to travel each day past a modern, fully equipped white school to a black school housed in a deteriorated building. By therefore filing suit, Reverend Brown, although he believed in salvation and the kingdom to come, sought to address systemic social inequities rooted in America's legal system in the kingdom at hand. The Brown case was consolidated with four others to be brought before the U.S. Supreme Court. On May 17, 1954, the court sided with Reverend Brown and the plaintiffs, declaring that segregation in public education is unconstitutional. Accordingly, one of history's most famous Supreme Court cases came about because a minister fought for civil reconciliation, demanding equitable treatment for his daughter. In regard to the social aspect of reconciliation, as exhibited by Reverend Oliver Brown, I believe no greater example exists of how the former influenced the latter than the civil rights movement's fight for equality and acceptance, which put into practice Paul's theology of equality. America's segregated schools were a daily reminder that society had not yet embraced reconciliation. In theory, at least, the Supreme Court's ruling in Brown would lead to gumbo-like diversity in America by opening school doors to blacks. In actuality, the pushback over Brown served as an impetus for the civil rights movement, setting the stage for America to meet another minister, this time in Montgomery, Alabama, about 18 months later, who also demonstrated a belief in human equality. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., then just 26 years old, preached a liberationist gospel that focused not only on the fact that Jesus died, but also on the fact that Jesus lived. King reminded the oppressed and their oppressors that Jesus' ministry was anchored in social liberation. Indeed, as Jesus' ministry began, he publicly professed, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Luke chapter 4, verses 18 through 19. Inspired by this example of liberationist ministry, King also sought to liberate the oppressed by challenging unjust laws with the Montgomery bus boycott. King's work towards civil reconciliation produced two easily observable and successful measures. 1. Passage of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and 2. Adoption of the government's policy on affirmative action. Both measures sought to foster reconciliation by bringing diverse people together for communal benefit. Peter had done the same thing when he baptized Cornelius, the first Gentile member of the church. Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 48. So, back to the stove. Good gumbo might contain shrimp and crab meat along with chicken and sausage. It's not simply enough to have seafood and meat. Different types of seafood and different types of meat make for good gumbo, just as different types of people and different types of perspectives from different types of people make for a cohesively functioning society and church. The Divided States of America. Notwithstanding the civil rights movement's success with civil reconciliation, some factions within the United States openly want a country that's as bland as broth, nothing like a good gumbo. This reality became especially evident through the Make America Great Again political narrative that drove Donald Trump's 2016 election to the presidency and continued to foster divisions in the church, especially between conservative white evangelicals and progressive black Protestants. As the political pendulum swung from Barack Obama to Donald Trump, white nationalist and neo-Nazi forces, which had been brewing during Obama's presidency, contributed significantly to Trump's election. Those factions were also emboldened to lead anti-minority spectacles, like the one in August 2017 in Charlottesville, Virginia. Further, the incendiary Make America Great Again political narrative also led to a rise in hate crimes. This empirically measured increase underscores the dramatic divisions and factions within the United States that have become even more pronounced in recent years. Several of those divisions emanate from the church. Some of America's church-based divisions are denominational. Accordingly, differences in orthodoxy are expected. Other divisions are historically social, like those between blacks and whites. Remember, for example, King's still sad maxim that 11 a.m. on Sunday mornings is the most segregated hour in America. I focus, however, on some theological divisions, such as those between conservative evangelicals and more liberal mainline Christians. Such divisions like those over a woman's right to choose under Roe v. Wade, 1973, have been at the heart of public policy debates, worsening religious and social divisions in the United States for more than 40 years. The counter-narrative to more conservative and dogmatic theologies has come from progressive and emancipatory faith traditions, including those within the black church that rose to prominence during the civil rights movement. The black church led the way in basing civil reconciliation in an ethic of equality premised on the social reconciliation in Paul's letters. Civil reconciliation places great value on diversity in American life while seeking to enforce the ethic of equality through governmental intervention and prophetic resistance. It is the same resistance that is at the heart of the Black Lives Matter movement. Social divisions and the Church's ministry of reconciliation. In a time marked by so much xenophobia and racial, religious, and social division, the Church's ministry of reconciliation is especially urgent. The Church today must repent of her divisions and return to her apostolic-era theology of equality to realize God's intention, as evidenced in Scripture, for a diverse and inclusive community of belonging. Doing so will allow the Church to be an exemplar for society. Further, just as society can benefit from the Church returning to a theology of equality, so the Church can benefit from secular world diversity and inclusion practices that value heterogeneity. In what follows, I conduct a multidisciplinary analysis that is rooted in theology, legal history, and diversity and inclusion principles. I begin with theological foundations and move through both historical and present-day analyses before connecting the Church's apostolic-era theology of equality with diversity principles within today's society and practices of inclusion. Part 1. The Theology of Reconciliation. Part 1 establishes a foundation for society to learn from the Church's evolving paradigm of reconciliation with the other. This part defines and connects salvific and social reconciliation, both foundationally anchored in six biblical texts: Matthew chapter 16 verses 13 through 19, Acts chapter 2 and chapter 10, Romans chapters 5 through 8, 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verses 17 through 22, Galatians chapter 3 verses 26 through 28, before examining a biblical trajectory that is rooted in the Church's origins and evolution. Part 1 explores Peter's leadership and Paul's theology alongside the civil rights movement's use of King as an exemplar in leading the black church towards civil reconciliation. Chapter 1 establishes a foundation for social reconciliation by looking at the word church, ecclesia, as originally introduced in Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 through 19, when Jesus calls Peter the rock upon which Jesus will build the church. Although social reconciliation is at the core of Paul's theology, it begins with Peter's leadership and goes through a chronological progression in Scripture. In Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 19, this extract, or pericope, is labeled Peter's declaration about Jesus, or Peter's confession. Jesus responds to Peter's indication of Jesus' lordship by rewarding Peter's faithfulness. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Chapter 16, verses 17 through 18. This is the first time the word church, ecclesia, appears in Scripture. Literally meaning an assembly or group, Jesus' reference is not to a physical structure with a steeple and vestibule, but to an assembly of people, or the body of Christ. Jesus intended this group, the ecclesia, to be diverse. With Peter designated to lead from a special place of honor in building the church, the book of Acts provides an early church history. Luke, its presumed author, tells of Peter preaching on the day of Pentecost, when thousands joined the church. Acts chapter 2. Indeed, those who joined and accepted Christ as the foretold Messiah did not join a building. They joined the ecclesia. Although the Pentecost narrative describes the diversity of those who joined the assembly, its original members were all Jews. Chapter 2, verse 5. The original church, therefore, began as a religiously homogeneous entity, unlike a richly diverse gumbo and more like a bland broth, that had not yet engaged in reconciliation with the other. Under Peter's leadership, however, the church's ethnic composition changed. In Acts chapter 10, before the New Testament progresses to the church's ministry of reconciliation in Paul's letters, a biblical version of unconscious bias appears. This is the same cognitive phenomenon that continually plagues society. When people make and manipulate stereotypes based on ethnicity, gender, religion, or sexual orientation, and unknowingly treat people unlike them as the other, they are drawing on and perpetuating unconscious bias. Indeed, they have the same reaction to social equity work that the Jewish Peter had after dreaming of the divisions between Jews and Gentiles being overcome. Acts chapter 10, verses 9 through 16. By no means, Lord. It was not until Peter rejected his bias and embraced the Gentile Cornelius as his equal that the church started moving toward reconciliation. This egalitarian ethic became the ethos of Paul's theology. Accordingly, before exploring the social dimensions of Paul's theology in chapter 2, I lay a foundation in chapter 1 that details Peter's leadership in facilitating reconciliation between Jews and Gentiles based on a divine revelation that Jesus came for all people. Chapter 2 builds on the foundational exploration of Peter's leadership in chapter 1 by looking at Paul's theology. By exploring Paul's theology of equality, most popularly manifested in Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 17 through 22, and Romans chapters 5 through 8, I provide a historical contextualization of social reconciliation. I argue that this type of reconciliation with the proverbial other, rooted in a Pauline theology of equitable relations within the church, lies at the heart of Paul's authentic writings. Chapter 3 moves from biblical examples of social reconciliation to placing Paul's theology of equality in the context of civil reconciliation. Martin Luther King Jr.'s leadership in the civil rights movement was an example of Paul's theology in practical application, as are the protests of today's Black Lives Matter activists. As these examples show, civil reconciliation essentially applies Paul's theology of equality in the form of demands of governmental redress. This remedy ensures that equitable treatment is not only moral, but also legal. Chapter 3 also focuses on forgiveness. true reconciliation requires that dominant and subjugated groups, such as whites and blacks, wipe the slate clean, as Bishop Tutu exhorted the citizens of South Africa to do after the hard work of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Thus, the Church's work towards civil reconciliation must continue. Indeed, this is the ministry that Jesus left to the Church. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 19. As a body moving toward reconciliation, the Church should continue its witness of transformation by working for more just and equitable political and socio-economic systems in society. Part 2. Reconciliation with the Other. Chapter 4 covers the reaction to progress made by the Black Church with passage of the Voting Rights Act of 1965 and the government's adoption of affirmative action, two of the civil rights movement's most quantifiable measures of success, at least in terms of diversity and inclusion. In the late 1960s, Richard Nixon's presidential campaign engaged in a Southern strategy, which sought to align conservative voters with white evangelical Christians in rejecting the racial progress associated with civil reconciliation. This conservative alliance, known as the religious right, proved to be a bedrock Republican Party constituency, especially after Ronald Reagan famously courted evangelicals in his successful 1980 presidential campaign. Chapter 4 highlights that this same conservative alliance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.